Welcome to Christchurch Online. This Sunday and next Sunday are very important Sundays for Jill and for me, because they're the last Sundays that we will be at Christchurch before I retire and we move on into our new ministry. So these two Sundays are something of a waymarker for both Jill and I and for Christchurch. As I was preparing for this service, I realised that what I really wanted to do was to share communion with you. As many of you will know, since the first lockdown in April last year, I've been celebrating communion on Christchurch's behalf. But we can't be together for that to happen. And so I thought I would use this service to share communion with you, even though we are separate and in our own homes. If that comes a bit of a surprise and you would like some time to prepare, then do please pause this service to get ready. But now let's open with prayer. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And as we trust ourselves to the Holy Spirit as he leads us through this service, let's worship our Lord Jesus Christ, our Saviour.
Shame was deeper than the sea, your grace.
We put our trust in the Lord Jesus and recognize that he is the only one who can bring us into the Father's presence. And so in his name, let us confess together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ came into this world to forgive sin. Hear then his word of pardon and his assurance of grace. As you have confessed, so are you forgiven. Glory be to God. Amen. And now let's turn to our Bible reading for this morning.
The reading today is from John 2, verses 1 to 11. Jesus changes water into wine. On the third day, a wedding took place in Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, "They have no more wine." "Woman, why do you involve me?" Jesus replied. "My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Nearby stood six stone water jars, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washing, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." So they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet." They did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He didn't realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, "Everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine, after the guests have had too much to drink. But you've saved the best till now." What Jesus did here in Cana of Galilee was the first of the signs through which he revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. This is the gospel of Christ.
Good morning, Christchurch. We're thinking today about the story of the wedding at Cana when Jesus changed water into wine. Now, some of you might remember in years gone by, it was the fashion for Christians, if you were of that persuasion, to wear a bracelet like this that had WWJD on it, standing for What Would Jesus Do? Well, today's story is a variation of that, today's sermon, WWJM. And the first W is wedding. We're going to think about weddings. If you think about the last wedding that you attended, this one wasn't much like it. It's highly likely that the marriage in today's reading was an arranged one. The couple would have been betrothed for about a year, and now the wedding is taking place. It's a wider affair than two people getting married. It's also about the joining of two families in support for the couple, and the celebrations probably lasted several days. The feast took place on the second day. Then the couple would retire and rejoin the celebrations for the next two or three days. And the whole village would have been invited. The closest equivalent I can think of is Jenny and Mark's wedding nearly 13 months ago when Christchurch was invited. And after the ceremony, the church was turned into the reception venue and many of us contributed to it. And there was a lovely family feeling, whether you were a friend or a relation. But I expect they're glad it didn't go on for several days. There is no explanation of why Mary or Jesus and his disciples were invited to this wedding at Cana, but we can assume that they were connected in some way to the families of the couple getting married. And for the servants to obey Mary and to do what Jesus told them to, perhaps indicates that they may well have had some importance as guests at this wedding. The second W is wine. Let's think about wine. Wine was commonly drunk in the Bible. It was a regular part of everyday meals. It varied in quality, as this story tells us. It's associated with rejoicing and gladness, with medical cleansing. Look up the Good Samaritan. It had to be tithed, just like any other produce, and was an important part of the Passover feast. It wasn't as alcoholic as the wine we might enjoy nowadays, but it was certainly possible to become intoxicated on it because there are warnings in the Old Testament against drinking too much, and in the New Testament, believers are warned not to get drunk on wine, but be filled with the Spirit, that's the Holy Spirit. So to have wine at any celebration was entirely normal and expected. And therefore, for the wine provided to not have been enough for the guests present would have been something of a social disaster. Now for J, Jesus. Jesus has come up from Bethany, where he was baptized, to the area of Galilee, where Cana was situated. And although he has gathered his disciples, he is, at this point, presumably best known in the local area as a carpenter. His disciples know enough about him to have wanted to follow him, but only Mary really knows who he actually is. When Jesus is approached by her because of the problem with the wine, his response, "It's not my time yet," shows that Jesus knows what she means by telling him, "This is not, Jesus, the bench leg has broken, can you fix it, situation. It's a much more significant request. She thinks this situation is something which needs a response that only Jesus can provide, a response that no one else could offer. She thinks it needs his attention as the Son of God. And if he responds to it in a miraculous manner, it will reveal his glory and encourage faith in him, which it does, of course, as the end of the reading tells us. Despite his first response, Jesus appears to decide that although his time is not yet, it is right for his time to begin. He requests the servants to fill the huge water jars with water. These jars are important. They were used for purification purposes, for the ritual cleansing necessary after you were somehow contaminated. As such, they're important because they're associated with the law. Jesus came to fulfill the Old Testament law, and when the water in the jars is turned to the best possible wine, it's a symbol of that coming fulfillment. It points towards the cross, towards the shedding of Jesus' blood, which is symbolized by the wine he shares with his disciples at the Passover feast, the Last Supper. Purification and cleansing from sin came through the law for the Jews. But now in Jesus, it will come by his grace, through the shedding of his blood, through his death, for everyone. And this miracle, this sign, begins in the abundance of the best wine provided, to point towards the abundance of mercy and forgiveness we find at the cross. John's Gospel is clear that the seven miracles or signs all point ultimately towards the cross. Each of them reveals something about Jesus' purpose and mission. Each of them is about transformation: water into wine, illness to wholeness, blindness to sight, death to life. Each of them is there so that everyone who reads the Gospel might believe that Jesus is the Son of God and have life in his name because they believe. And now to M, Mary. At this point, as I said, only Mary knows who Jesus fully is. She's known him all his earthly life. She's loved him and looked after him and cooked his meals and washed his clothes and brought him up. We presume Jesus has been living at home with Mary and working in the locality as a carpenter up until the time of his ministry beginning. Mary said, "Hineni, here I am," when the angel told her about who her son Jesus would be. She was there when the shepherds arrived to visit him. She may well have put the precious gifts from the wise men away somewhere safe. She heard what Simeon and Anna had to say about him in the temple. She was anxious when he appeared to be lost at the age of 12, only to be found in his father's house. And all the 30 or so years from his birth to this point, she has been pondering, treasuring, holding all of this deeply in her mind and dearly to her heart. She knows exactly who he is. So I wonder if, when it comes to her attention that the wine at this wedding has run out, whether she thinks, "Now? Is it time?" The two things Mary says in this story are the last things we hear her say in the Gospels, so I think they're worthy of our attention. Firstly, she takes the problem to Jesus. "There's no more wine," she tells him. She draws his attention to the potential for a social disaster. And she doesn't appear to be disheartened by his response. She's taken the problem to him. And in the second thing she says, advising the servants to do whatever he tells you to do, she shows that she trusts him to fix it. She trusts that Jesus will tell them what to do so that the problem will be fixed. And it is gloriously, abundantly fixed with wonderful new wine. What a lovely, simple, profound example of faith. Something's gone wrong? Take it to Jesus. Something's confusing? Take it to Jesus. The future is uncertain? Take it to Jesus. And repeat. And repeat. And our response to any situation, we take to him. And our encouragement to anyone else is to do what he tells us to. Not to do what we think he would do, but simply to obey what he says. Let's go back to those "what would Jesus do" bracelets. They were designed, I guess, to help people make decisions in a Christ-like way. The trouble was, and could still be, the answer to that question is up to our interpretation. And sometimes what we think Jesus would do in a particular situation is not the same as what someone else thinks. I can remember at least one occasion where someone said, "Well, I think Jesus would do this." And someone else replied, "Well, I think he would do that." Going about things like that makes it more about our personal opinion and not about what Jesus actually says. The best way is simply to listen to what Jesus tells us to do and then to go and do it. I can't think of a better way to end my final sermon for us at Christchurch than to encourage us all to follow Mary's example and Mary's advice. as disciples of Jesus. Whatever happens, let's take it to him. And then let's DWJS. Do what Jesus says. Amen.
As we rejoice in all that Jesus has done for us and in all that Jesus is for us, let's join in together the words of the Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you. We give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. As we agree together by saying Amen, in the greatness of our God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Now let's think and pray together.
Hi there, Sarah here. Just a quick note to let you know what our children at Christchurch have been up to. We are having an in-depth look at Joseph for the next 5 weeks. So here come some pictures of what the children got up to last week.
I thought I did what's right. I thought I had the answers. I thought I chose the surest road, but that road brought me here. So I put up a fight and told you how to help me. Now just when I have given up, the truth is coming clear. You know better than I. You know the way. I've let go the need to know why. For you know better than I. If this has been a test, I cannot see the reason, but maybe knowing I don't know is part of getting through. I try to do what's best, and faith has made it easy to see the best thing I can do is put my trust in you. For you
Roberta, and I will be leading prayers this morning. And if you'd like to place your hands on your lap, palms up, and together we are going to put all our thoughts and our worries and our hopes into God's hands. We're also going to be having some prayer responses. So when I say, Lord, in your mercy, you say, hear our prayer. So let's pray together. We place in your hands, God, our church, our wardens, TCC, Sunday groups, the Resource Food Bank, the online service team, and everyone who makes Christ Church run. And also our entire congregation, those who are around us and those we have not seen for weeks and months. We place into your hands, God, David and Jill, as they leave Christ Church at the end of the month and into their new home and community. Lord, please take our frustrations, our difficulties, our worries about our future. We place into your hands, God, our international church, all the people in the world who bring God's love to others, and all people who are persecuted for sharing the love of God. Lord God, you have blessed us. Help us to bring blessings into your world too. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We place into your hands, God, a world that needs peace, healing, and wisdom. Be with every nation in our world and their leaders. As we heard in the gospel this morning, be with the poor, the prisoners, the blind, the burdened, and the battered, those who live in fear, and all who hold the lives of others in their hands. Lord God, you have put so much love into our world. Help us to make it a more loving place. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We place into your hands, God, our families, friends, neighbors, and those who live and work in our community, our local shops and businesses, those who work from home, those who go to work, those who are unemployed or furloughed, and our critical workers. We place into your hands, God, all who are suffering, need healing, strength, and peace. We name this morning Mike and Rod. Lord God, bless them with your love, comfort, and healing. Show us how to care and support for them and their families. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We have worshipped and we have prayed. We have listened to the Word of God and thought about it. Now let's focus on the communion words together. The Lord is with us. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give you thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread, gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit, that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. In the proclamation of these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you our sacrifice of praise and lift our voices to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. In Christ we are one. Separated, we are one, because of our Lord Jesus, because of his Holy Spirit, because of the love of the Father. Let us pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and for ever. Amen. In the one true living bread, who is Jesus Christ our Lord, we join together, rejoicing in our salvation. Let us pray together. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. And may the blessing of God Almighty, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be upon you and among you, both this day and always. Amen. As we have worshipped together in this communion service, if you have any questions or would like to make contact with Christchurch, then do please use the contact details on the card at the end of this service. But now, as we conclude our worship for today, let's focus on our Lord Jesus Christ and our great and wonderful God.
Each day.